My name is Nick Merrill. I am presenting today some work on internet fragmentation, which I call Beyond Free and Closed. I direct the Daylight Security Research Lab at the Center for Long-Term Cybersecurity. And starting about a year ago, we started seeing headlines like this. The splinternet is already here. The splinternet is growing. And then World Economic Forum published this white paper, Internet Fragmentation, an Overview. So our question was, what is internet fragmentation? Well, the intuitive picture here is that this supposedly global internet is becoming increasingly different in different countries. In other words, national borders are coming to matter more as far as your experience of the internet goes. Now, the internet was never truly global in the first place, but certainly there's something to be said for recent kind of nationalistic trends where, you know, maybe China would block an American website more recently, because I think we're all aware the US may be tempted to block Chinese websites and apps as well. So the consequences here, of course, for, you know, freedom of speech might be consequences for investment, technological development, and also for political relations. Now, I will talk more about this political relations thing later. When we started this project, it was not very clear to people that blocking websites was a political relations issue. It seemed more like maybe a domestic issue, something like that. I think with the TikTok fiasco, it's become more intuitive to a US audience that this is indeed a political relations issue. Anyway, how do we measure internet fragmentation? That was actually our main question. All of the headlines I showed you before are really trading in anecdote. And we were looking for a way to discuss internet fragmentation quantitatively so that we can measure trends over time, velocity, trajectory, and stuff like that. Now, when measuring internet fragmentation, it is critical to remember that the internet is actually made up of many technologies. We typically talk about the internet stack or the TCP/IP stack. These are websites that are built on top of each other. There's a physical layer, there's a kind of an abstractions above that layer, including application layer where we actually go to a website, and above that, there are laws that, you know, even dictate the way information can flow across borders. Data locality laws, like in Russia, or even laws like GDPR in the EU. So for each of these layers of the TCP/IP stack, we found a proxy, something that we can quantify, that can that we can leverage to discuss fragmentation at that layer. So for any given country, we can come up with some number that describes their fragmentation at each of these. Again, we only did layers 2 through 5, each of these 4 layers. So what we came up with were these spider charts. They describe the fragmentation profile of a given country. Now, here are 4 interesting examples. On one, you see this probably very big green shape here. This is China. So we see that China has a wide degree of fragmentation on all of the 4 layers that we measured. Inside, we see, you know, the US has less fragmentation. And you know, when we see Bahrain, for example, is fragmented only on IPv6 layer. Now, the critical thing to notice here is that fragmentation is diverse. We have different profiles of fragmentation among different countries. So does that mean that every country in the world is unique? No. Okay, here's Denmark, Sweden, and Norway, 3 countries that have close historical, linguistic, social, economic ties. And we see that their internet fragmentation profiles are actually very similar. But, and you're probably already wondering about China, China's is unique, and we can even compare it. There's this popular anecdote out there that China is exporting its model of the internet, has its Belt and Road allies, and it's pushing its network, its model of the internet to these Belt and Road allies. We do not find evidence of that. China is quite different from the numerical average of its Belt and Road allies. What we find actually is that the internet is multipolar. There are different internet governance decisions worldwide, and those produce diverse types of fragmentation. This is a fundamentally different story from what you hear in these kind of anecdotal reports about the closed internets and the free internets. It's a lot more complicated than that. Even when you compare the US and Norway, we see Norway has some degree of, let's say, active governance over its internet. Is this fragmentation? Sure. Is it a closed internet? Depends who you ask, right? They don't necessarily censor politically sensitive websites, so you might not consider it closed. But fragmentation is there if you know how to measure it. Now, here is a chart that I love. There's actually an interactive visualization here. I can put it in the chat after this talk. This is a force-directed graph of similarities between countries based on what websites they block. And there's more detail about the methodology at this link. But basically what we see is that based on website blocking alone, just at the application layer, we see that there's this one cluster of really interoperable internets. Most countries we measured have internets that are pretty much similar to one another. They all kind of either block the same thing or don't block much. Around the periphery, we have countries that have some degree of blocking. Ukraine, Hong Kong, Vietnam. These are countries that flirt. I would say they have this uneasy relationship or trade-off they're exploring between internet sovereignty and interoperability with the main global internet. And then out on the corners here, you see these countries who have gone all the way with blocking. Russia, Turkey, Venezuela, one surprise with South Korea, India, China. Okay, these countries have decided to leave the cluster. They have formed their own, in a way, internet that is less interoperable with the global internet. Now, there are some interesting relationships we can discuss between Russia, Turkey, Saudi Arabia. They have similarities. It's not clear, though, that they have formed their own tight interoperable cluster in the way that the rest of the world really has. And the US is still in there, in case you were wondering. So one thing that was very interesting once we compiled all this data is that we tried to correlate it with other kinds of political relations issues, like military alliances and trade agreements. And guess what? Website blocking strategies do correlate with these types of agreements. In fact, we can predict pretty well, based on your website blocking strategy alone, whether you are in a trade agreement or a military alliance with another country. All right, so what? You know, this is interesting, but so what? I published this op-ed in The Hill pretty recently, which has kind of a hyperbolic, but I stand by it, headline, "Show me who bans TikTok, and I'll show you who your future allies are." If the US does go ahead with blocking TikTok and WeChat, which obviously there's been a lot of kerfuffle, I would say the future is still indeterminable as of right now, then we can actually start to make predictions based on who follows suit. For example, if the US blocks TikTok and the EU decides not to block TikTok, then we can reasonably predict that the EU is going to be more likely to trade with China. It's going to be more likely to cooperate militarily with China. And the US may become estranged from the EU a little bit as a result. In general, when you block websites unilaterally, you isolate yourself. Again, you can remember this chart. I am deciding to block a website, let's say Venezuela, right? You just move further and further away from the global internet. But it's not just the global internet you're moving away from, it's the global community. And it's not because necessarily internet blocking strategies cause changes to trade relation. In fact, you know, internet governance strategies most likely both reflect policies and drive policies. I'm taking these internet governance decisions because of these other attitudes I have toward the global community, and maybe, you know, these internet blocking strategies further isolate me as well. So there could be a two-way causal relationship here, but it's robust enough that it counts to talk about. So what now? Well, for policymakers, our big message is that internet governance is more than a technical issue. This isn't just about kind of some strong opinions we have about how the internet should work. Really, internet governance is about who you want to ally with. Who do you want to trade with? Do you want to be isolated in the global community? And you know, maybe you do. Country like China, maybe they want to have a little bit of more isolation from the global community versus this kind of interoperability or reliance multilateralism. And the second major thing here is that internet governance could be a leading indicator of geopolitical shifts. You know, with a lot of these kind of trade agreements, military alliances, we have to wait for formal pacts. When it comes to measuring trade, we have to kind of look at boats leaving and coming to ports and all of these messy kinds of data. With internet governance strategy, and especially with something like website blocking, transition from IPv4 to IPv6, we can measure this stuff in real time. So think about a kind of real-time anomaly detection sort of digital approach to finding shifts in kind of the geopolitical lay of the land. And I think as we shift into this kind of increasingly non-polar, unstable geopolitical reality, could be helpful to have this kind of real-time indicator of shifts on the ground. So with that, I'd like to thank William and Flora Hewlett Foundation and CLTC for funding this work, and also my amazing research assistants, Akhilesh Pandita, Lily Bhattacharjee, Renata Barreto, Neha Mittal, and Mahmoud Hamsha. Thank you.